let them scare you, guys. Don't let them scare you. Rick from Rick's Rock School back for another Coheed lesson. Some of you are like, oh, great, the guy that smiles too much is back. Yes, back for another Coheed tutorial. We're doing Devil in Jersey City today. Devil in Jersey City, this one means a lot to me. First and foremost, if you couldn't tell, I'm from the great state of New Jersey, specifically a little town outside of Atlantic City, New Jersey, called Smithville or Leeds Point. It's actually where the legend of the Jersey Devil originates. So I was kind of born into that Jersey Devil mysticism, you know, but their gift shops also sold Jersey Devil t-shirts and things of that nature. So when I heard this song when I was in high school, I'm like, they're singing about me. They're singing about where I'm from. This is the coolest thing in the world. I didn't know anything about the Amory Wars or that it's, you know, a New Jersey that exists in a different dimension. But to me, they were singing about me and I loved it. So we're gonna do this. And another reason when I heard this song, and again, heavy guitars, great lead guitar work by Travis, it immediately went on to my iPod classic back in high school, and it remained, and I would listen to it on the bus and this, that, and the other thing. And it meant a lot because I took that Coheed, all Second Stage Turbine Blade, made it onto my iPod classic, and I took that with me. Right after high school, I ended up on this long odyssey, this tour, if you will. I went on tour with my band out of high school. We went all up and down the East Coast, everywhere from the northern Pennsylvania all the way down to the southern Florida, and everywhere in between. And all kinds of crazy stuff happened. I traded my 1982 Gibson Flying V for a 1990 Chevy conversion van. We hopped in the van and we went, and we had an idea of how this would go, and it didn't go according to plan, and squirrels ate all of our wheat thins, and it was a tragedy. Now, and that's a story for another time. Actually, no, what? I'll tell the story. So we have a 3-day layover between show in Springfield, Virginia at a place called Empire. Guar had played there the night before, so I thought that was really cool. 3 days later, we had a show in Richmond, so we had to kill 3 days. Hotels were getting expensive. We were running out of money. So the other people in the band have this great idea. Let's go camping. There's this place, we see a brochure, it's called Bear Creek Lake State Forest. We can hang out there for $20 a day and that'll be fine. So we went to a Walmart in a place called Farmville, Virginia. Yes, it actually exists. Check out Farmville, Virginia. Shout out if you know it. So we're in Farmville, Virginia. They got a super Walmart, as they do. And we load up and we get one box of frozen cheeseburgers and some hot dogs, and a giant sale on wheat thins. They're going 2-for-1 on wheat thins. Okay, let's get 6 boxes of wheat thins. Just one box of hamburgers, one pack of hot dogs, and 6 boxes of wheat thins. That's enough food for 5 people for 3 days, or so we thought. So we get this done, and we eat the burgers on the first day, and then with 2 days left in this odyssey of a camping trip waiting for our show in Richmond, Virginia, we have only wheat thins left, and we're not going to be able to survive on wheat thins for 2 days. So I decided that I'm going to go all Survivor Man. I'm going to go Bear Grylls on this. I said, guys, let me go down to the port store. Let me get a fishing rod and some worms. I'm going to go fishing, and we're going to eat fresh fish from the lake, Bear Creek Lake, and it'll be great. Okay. So the rest of the band, they go with me. The drummer says, I'm going to hang out here and watch the van. Cool. So we go, and we're going to get the fishing stuff. We come back, and what we come back to is an absolute disaster zone. There are wheat thin boxes strewn about. In my memory, there's like smoke coming from the ground, like some camp had been raided. And I said to the drummer, I said, Andrew, what happened to all of our wheat thins? He's like, dude, they attacked from the left, they attacked from the right, they attacked from the top of the van. Squirrels, I took a nap. He goes, I took a nap in the van, and squirrels had jumped in to every opening of this van, found the wheat thins, tore them up. They stole our wheat thins. We had no food for 2 days. And about the fishing, I don't know if you've ever fished, not because you wanted to, but because you were hungry. But when you fish because you want to, you generally catch things. When you fish because you are hungry, fish don't exist. So we went 2 days, no wheat thins, no food, roughed it. Could not be happier to get to the Wendy's in Richmond, Virginia when we got there. And I guess the moral of the story here, guys, is don't go on tour without funding. Don't jump in a band. It was fun, but anyways, let's get to it, guys. So Devil in Jersey City, on the way back, After that show in Richmond, the bass player finds out that there's going to be a warrant out for his arrest if he doesn't get back to New Jersey and take care of some things. So we had to go back to New Jersey, and we were all pretty bummed because we thought, okay, we just played this show. We got a little money. We could make our way down further south. We had shows to do in Florida and Atlanta, Georgia, and everything else. So we're kind of heartbroken, and I'm on the way back to New Jersey, and I see the sign that says New Jersey is 50 miles away. We're going up I-95, and I go, this is a good time to put on some Coheed, put on Devil in Jersey City. There's something about this song that made me feel a great sense of hope. So nobody requested that I do this. I wanted to do this one. Devil in Jersey City, guys, let's get to it. We're gonna start on this B power chord. And go to a D. So we got B power chord on the 7th fret of the E string. And you start just ripping open. So you get 7th fret E, 9th fret A, 9th fret D. I'll assume we all know how to play a power chord from here on out. We're gonna hit it with a down strum, and then we start palm muting. Now, when you palm mute, you wanna use the karate chop. If you're having problems getting that wonderful, chunky, heavy sound that makes you wanna throw chairs against a wall, you gotta use the karate chop part of your hand here. We're gonna use the karate chop part, and that's gotta go as far back on the bridge as it will allow. So you wanna rest your hand right up in this vicinity. The further back you are, the chunkier it's gonna sound. As opposed to. See, it gets heavier as you bring that back. So that should be rested against that tailpiece. Then we're gonna hit the D power chord on the 10th fret of the E string. Open and then start chugging. To the G. Now, when I'm palm muting the B and the D, I'm down strumming everything. That gives you that wonderful heavy chunk sound. But when we get to the G, I personally alternate strum this. We're still palm muting. Different feel, a little bit of a different feel, so that when we get back to the B, it gets back to being wonderfully heavy, and that palm mute sound starts to sound fresh again. That is just something to take with you in your play, for your playing in general here. Now we start down strumming again, that starts heavy. That's how you play the main riff. That's how you play Claudio's main riff. Travis is gonna tail on the B chord and the D chord. The lead, when the G chord comes in, for those of you going, okay, it sounds like way more is going on than just a G over and over again. Because there is, the bass has its own thing going on. I'll actually run through that too. Bass has its own thing going on, but then Travis's lead, he brings so much melodicism to this band, like we've talked about over and over and over again. So this is that lead. We're gonna hit a D note on the 12th fret of the D. What you wanna do is you wanna bar the 10th fret of the E and the B string. Bar the E and the B at the 10th fret so we can play this lick properly. You're gonna get the 12th fret of the D here. And then we're gonna pick the 12th fret E, 10th fret E, and the 10th fret of the B. So, and the pattern's gonna go like this. So we're gonna pedal off of this 10th fret B, this A note. 12th fret E to the 10, to the 10 on the B. 14 E, 10 E, 10 E. Back to 12, this time to 15th fret to the G note, to the 17th fret. So you get. And we're gonna do that twice. You're gonna do that twice while Claudio is on the G. And that's how we play the opening segment. They're gonna do that all the way around again. That's four times total. The third time though, you're gonna play it open, no palming. Back, one more with the palming. All that, then we're gonna get to this. Now, we're gonna play this part here is the 5th fret of the E string. It's an A power chord. To the B. All right? Now you're gonna do that, you're gonna hit that open, and then the B chord twice, and then three times where we don't hold that first one as long. So you're gonna hit that open, hold, and then to the B twice. And then you're gonna hit three of them where we don't hold that A quite as long. So all together you get. That's gonna bring us to this. So we hit a G power chord. Then you're gonna go open D, 7th fret D, 5th fret, 4. So we're gonna have our A note, G note, F sharp, E note, D note. To a G power chord. Make sure you're alternate picking, or you're not gonna get that right. Then we go back to. More palm muting. Love it. More palm muting, but it's an A power chord, 5th fret, to a G power chord on the 3rd fret. Now we're gonna go back to the verse. It's gonna do that all over again. The next time it gets back to that, we are going to the chorus. The power chords, Claudio's part for the chorus. Power chord part is gonna be B, A, and G. And we'll go like this. Quick F sharp on the upbeat, G. So that's the chorus. B, A, G, we hit that F sharp, B, A, F sharp, G. Rock out on that G power chord. So that's your power chords. If you're playing the rhythm part, if you're doing Claudio's part, that's what you gotta do. The lead is gonna go like this. So, and then, so Travis, I'm gonna get to where that triad comes in, but over the B chord and the A chord, he's going. That's gonna be 5th fret of the D, we're gonna hammer to the 7, back to the 5, 9th fret A with our pinky, to the 5th fret A with our first finger, so you get it. They get a double stop here, 7G and 7B with just the ring finger. Now we have the 6th fret of the G, we have a C sharp, and we have an E. Right there. So you have a 5th fret of the B string and the 6th fret of the G. So it's. Great triad. This is a suspended triad, a G sus 2 triad. Now, here's an A note. Here's a D note, here's a B note. We are missing the G. You don't actually have to play the root of a chord. So this is both an inversion and a suspension. Seems like a lot, but it's easy to play. 4th fret of the G, 3rd fret of the B, and the 5th fret of the E string. And you get, and then, so you're gonna hit. And then he'll just start playing it as an arpeggio. Another triad he'll play here on the 4th fret of the G, the 3rd fret of the B, and the 3rd fret of the E string is just a G major triad. So you get G sus 2 and a G major triad. All right, so that takes us through the intro and the verse. And the chorus, we are now getting to the bridge. This is my favorite part of the entire song. Let's check this out. Let's go clean tone here. So let's do this. That old bit about suspended chords. Here's another one. A sus 2. When we take the A, if we're back in the key of D, and we start on A, we would have A, B, C sharp, D, and E. OK? Okay. Now, A, C sharp, and E would normally make our regular A major chord. If we replace the C sharp with the second, the B note, you get this. Very open sound. If you replace it with the fourth, the D note, you get this. So this is the sus4, the major chord, and the sus2. So this is gonna open up like this. Gonna be an A sus 2. Second fret D, second fret G, the open B, the open E, the open A. You can block out your low E just if you don't want it to sound too muddy. Stay real light on your left hand. Don't dent the marshmallow. And you can hear in the recording, it goes to a C sharp with that pinky and then a D note. So you're gonna go to that second fret B with the pinky, then the third fret, then we're gonna switch here. A G major chord. 5D, 4G, 3B, and we're gonna add the pinky to the fifth fret of the E, the A note, to make it G sus 2. And we'll play a little arpeggio. Love that. So, the A sus 2, G sus 2, pinky, that arpeggio, that's what's gonna lead us to this. Now, this is just a beautiful piece of lead guitar. It's not flashy, it's just very, very effective. It's very emotional. So check this out. So we're gonna hit our open D string. 7th fret of the D, 5th fret, 4th fret, you get D, A, G, F sharp, E, F sharp, D. Now we're going to go to the 7th fret of the D, the A note, and we'll go, I'm going to hit that a couple times, alternate, to the open D. Now we're gonna start alternate picking the E note, second fret of the D string. We'll slide up to that 7th, to the open D, and then they're gonna play 6 to 7. We'll hammer on 6th fret of the G to the 7th fret. Hit it again. Now to the 7th fret of the B. Twice, and then to the 7th fret of the G. That's it for the clean part. Let's end this out. So we're gonna end on the chorus chords, and you can play the lead, if you can play Travis's lead exactly the way I showed you. Or we could do it a complete octave up. I feel like they double tracked it on the recording. And it ends right there. 5th fret of the D, 5th fret of the D to the 7th fret. And if we just move that up 12 frets, 17 to 19. 21st fret of the A to the 17th fret of the A. Now we have the 19th fret of the G and the B. Twice, and then we have 18 and 17. And it's gonna end just like that again. Guys, thanks so much for watching. Until next time, guys, keep rocking. And remember, it's supposed to be fun. Have fun with it.